This is Living History Footnotes for the Sudbury Regreening story. If you haven't seen the main episode yet, please check it out now. I will link it in the description. In today's episode, I'm going to offer a slight correction to a shot that I included in the main episode. We're going to talk about Laurentian University and the legacy of regreening, and we're also going to learn about a ghost town right here in Sudbury that is pollution-based. All that and more, so let's get into it. It's been a little while since I've done a featured comment for one of these videos, and on this particular video there are too many wonderful, lovely comments to choose from, quite frankly, so I'm just going to put a big list of them on screen now. Please pause if you want to. I also want to give a very special thanks to Larry for the contribution on my Ko-fi page. It really helps a lot with this series. I don't have any funding for it, so it's just coming from you folks, so if you would also like to support and keep these videos coming, please visit my Ko-fi page. It's linked in the description. Alright, so now without further ado, it's time for me to make a correction. Alright, here's a really stupid correction to have to make. In the main video, I was standing next to this tree and talking about how the 10 millionth tree was planted in Sudbury with Justin Trudeau and Jane Goodall. And in fact, I do believe this is the tree that I should have been talking about, although I'm still not 100% certain because, like I said, I was out of town when that happened, but correcting the records to say that is number 10 million. And there is nothing on it. There is no plaque, nothing to delineate that history. You can't blame me, can you? Yeah, you should. As Coach would say, that's embarrassing. Oh, but our story is not done there. Even if that is the Justin Trudeau, Jane Goodall tree like I think it is, that one isn't number 10 million. According to the official statement from the city of Greater Sudbury, the actual official 10 millionth tree is located next to the commemorative stone elsewhere in Bell Park. But there's still more. While I was doing my back research, I found quotes from people that are about a decade old claiming that the city was already at 15 million trees back then. So I don't know if anybody knows the exact official number of the number of trees that have been planted in Sudbury, and I suppose it would be difficult to quantify considering there are so many different partners on the effort. If you have any idea what the true Sudbury regreening number should be, let me know in the comments. And before I switch topics, I do want to say that I think that this is kind of besides the point. The main thing is there are so many more trees around here than there once was, and regardless of how many the actual number is, that is still a reason to celebrate. Although, okay, there's way too many all those on this story, but when I visited the supposed Justin Trudeau, Jane Goodall tree, I noticed that despite it being very new, it already seemed to have some sort of infection. However, upon further reading, I figured out that this is likely a condition called tar spot, which is not harmful for trees and is also extremely common among specific species like the maple that was planted then, and funny enough, this maple that I'm standing next to right now. And while I'm still doing some corrections here, I left a name off of the credits and I feel really bad about this. My friend Ashish Von Contractor helped me out with some of the filming up at Daisy Lake Uplands, and I did not include her name on the list. I'm very sorry, Ashu. Consider yourself on the record now. Let's go back now to the very beginnings of regreening in Sudbury because it has a very curious origin story. Obviously, this was work that needed to happen at some point, but it was mass layoffs that really kicked this process into high gear. You see, in 1977, nickel prices absolutely cratered. And so there were mass layoffs. Inco laid off thousands of people at the time, so there was a lot of unemployment in the Sudbury area. The regreening program began sort of as a make work project, offering summer jobs to miners that were laid off, and they got paid probably a higher wage than ordinary replanters would have been making at that time. However, of course, once it was proven to be a successful idea, regreening continues to be a process that's happening to this day. In the main episode, we touched upon a couple of the, perhaps, blemishes on an otherwise stellar Sudbury regreening story, and I'd like to talk about one more of those now, and that is the recent insolvency and restructuring of Laurentian University. Now, as part of this restructuring process, the university decided to slash a lot of its programs, and one of those programs that it cut was its environmental science degrees. These were some of the very programs that basically worked out the science to make regreening possible. And there's been a lot of criticism in the community that now that this school, which created so much good in the environmental world, is no longer offering these programs, it really does put a stain on the legacy of this project. Some people say it's kind of a poor and unsatisfying end to what is otherwise an amazing story. However, it'll remain to be seen whether other schools might pick up the torch here in Sudbury and continue that work and maybe become the new leaders in restoring damaged environments. Time will tell. Last up, I want to acknowledge that the main Sudbury regreening episode was pretty valet heavy. The other major miner in the area is Glencore, formerly known as Falconbridge. Now that company has its origins in the 1920s when people moved to start exploiting an ore body that was first discovered by none other than Thomas Edison. Now, Glencore has been a major contributor to the regreening efforts as well, but it's also had its share of environmental challenges through the years. And one that really stands out to me is the story of a town called Happy Valley. Happy Valley was a small community in a valley just to the south of the Falconbridge mine complex. It was originally a farming community, but eventually pollution started to harm the land. The government said it was no longer safe to live there, the people were pushed out, and the town was bulldozed in the 1970s. In the main episode, I showed you this photo, which is from the original Happy Valley town site. It's by a photographer named Patrick Cummins, and the photo dates back to 1982. Patrick was kind enough to let me use this photo for my episode, and I really do want to say thank you, Patrick, for that. I've also linked his website and his Flickr page in the description, and I would encourage you to check out. He has some really interesting works from past and present in Ontario. I've also linked a couple of great stories about the rise and fall of Happy Valley that are a really interesting read. Please check them out. They're in the description. That is it for this week's episode of Living History Footnotes about the Sudbury regreening story. As always, I encourage you to visit these places for yourself, especially Sudbury, because like I'm here and we could hang out or something. When you do visit, please take a photo, tag me on Instagram. I'm at livinghistoryca and use hashtag livinghistoryca as well, just so I have a better chance of seeing it. Next week, we have a new episode coming your way, and we're going to be staying right here in Sudbury. I'm going to bring you a story of how before NASA would let some of its astronauts walk on the moon, they had to first walk in Sudbury. Until then, be well. In fact, this pine, oh, that's not a pine tree, it's a maple, Jesus Christ.